stay, I'll stay. When you move, I'll move. I will follow.
Trust in you, Lord. devil thought he had me. He thought my life was. He thought by now I. He thought I had no. Let's do that again. The devil thought he had me. He thought my life was. He thought by now I. He thought I had no. But that's when someone.
The words of the song, because it talks about the strong and powerful God, the leader of all, the creator of all, the Lion of Judah. But I also love the reference to the merciful, forgiving, loving God, the Lamb of God who gave his life for us. What a wonderful God we serve. He is our solid rock. He's the hope that we have because of His blood for us.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest rain, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. When darkness veils His lovely face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand.
Christ the solid rock I stand on.
this next song. Because we have that firm foundation in Jesus, we have that rock that we can trust in. We can turn to Him. We can ask Him to fill us and to use us. And that's what this song talks about.
Beautiful Lord, wonderful Savior, I know for sure all of my days are held in your hand, grafted into your perfect plan. You gently call to your presence, guiding me by your Holy Spirit. Teach me, dear Lord, to live all of my life through your eyes. I'm captured by your holy calling. Set
I preparing for this morning, I went back and I looked over all that we've been studying in this series since about mid-February, because in mid-February, that's about when we got to the middle of Luke 4, where Jesus begins his Galilean ministry. And that ministry in Galilee begins with him being rejected in his own hometown in a local synagogue in Nazareth because those people there were offended by the message of grace. They were offended that Jesus, this unlikely Messiah, was teaching that a person's entrance into heaven, into the kingdom of God, was not going to be based on their religiosity or their ethnicity or their heritage, but that a person's entrance into the kingdom of God was based solely on God's grace. And so then, as Jesus called the 12 disciples to follow him, he would talk about the kingdom of God in ways that they had never heard before. And he mentions those that are a part of the kingdom of God. And it's an amazing thing for them to hear. I mean, come on, think about it, friends. Imagine a kingdom where those who are in that kingdom know that they do not deserve to be in the kingdom. Where those who are a part of that kingdom know that it's only by the grace of the King that they're in the kingdom in the first place. And that King's grace becomes their motive for how they live. And they live very differently from those who are outside of the kingdom. They do crazy stuff like love their enemies. Who does that? They bless and they pray for those who insult them. They take ridicule in stride. Who does that? Who lives like that? Those who have been changed by grace. They're also, interestingly enough, as Jesus shares in the Sermon on the Mount, they're liberal with their stuff. They give their stuff away. They're generous. And they lend to people money and don't expect to be repaid. Who does that? People who have been changed by grace. They discern people's actions, but they restrain themselves from judging people's motives. Now, come on, who does that? I mean, judging people's motives is sort of what social media is for, right? Why would anybody live in a way that demonstrates that kind of love, that kind of mercy, that kind of restraint, and that kind of generosity? Why would anybody live like that? Friends, simply because they've been changed by the grace of the King who reigns over this kingdom that Jesus is talking about in the Sermon on the Mount. And that's what it's all about, friends. And today, as we look at how Jesus ends the Sermon on the Mount, we're going to see him hone in on what a real follower of his looks like. It's in those last 10 verses that we just heard read where Jesus teaches us that distinct from the rest of the world, those who have been changed by the gospel of grace live differently. That's our big idea today. That those who have been changed by the gospel of grace live differently. Think about it. When we follow Jesus as citizens of his kingdoms, we live in a different way than the rest of the world. And as we continue today looking at Luke chapter 6, and I hope you kept your Bible open because you're going to need it. Jesus, what he does here is he drives the point home by making three different contrasts. And I've listed those contrasts for you in your outline notes this morning. Three contrasts, and in each one of those contrasts, Jesus uses an illustration. But there's also in each one of those contrasts a kingdom fact that we can conclude from Jesus' illustration. And each kingdom fact is a truth that sheds light on the difference between a real follower and someone who's not. Again, those who have been changed by the gospel of grace live differently. So let's jump right into it. Let's look at the first contrast that was read just moments ago. Number one on your outline is blind eyes versus seeing eyes. Blind eyes versus seeing eyes. Now, it's interesting to me that the contrast between sight and blindness comes up quite a bit in Jesus' ministry. There are several instances in the gospel accounts where Jesus restores sight to someone who was blind. That was a miraculous healing at that time. And it's also one of the promises from the Old Testament that God's word said Messiah would do when he arrives. He would restore sight to the blind. But those instances of Jesus healing blind people simply pointed to a greater reality. And that these blind people actually receive sight, but it points to a greater miracle. And that miracle is salvation in Jesus Christ. See, before God saves anyone, we are blind to the truth of the gospel. That's the lost state. We don't understand the gravity of our own sin. Therefore, we don't understand our need for a Savior. Lost people are blind. As was I before God in His grace revealed the truth of the gospel to me. As were many of you. It was by God's doing that I was blind and now see. But the immediate problem in Jesus' day was that the religious leaders then, who were supposed to be preparing the people for the kingdom of God, those religious leaders were blind themselves. And that's why Jesus gives his disciples a critical warning. Look at verse 39 in your Bibles with me and see what Jesus asks first. Verse 39, this critical warning, Jesus asks, can the blind guide the blind? Won't they both fall into a pit? These are two rhetorical questions, right? That both are not hard to figure out because the answer to both of them is yes. Can a blind person lead a blind person? Yes, but it's not going to go well. Won't they both fall into a pit? Yes, of course. That's why this is a warning, friends. Because the saddest thing about this critical warning is that the blind person being led doesn't realize that the person leading them is also blind until it's too late. Keep reading in verse 40. Look at what Jesus goes on to say. He says, a disciple is not above his teacher, but everyone who is fully trained will be like his teacher. Again, Jesus is giving a warning here. And that warning is to learn before teaching. Learn before teaching. There are warnings all over the Old Testament and all over the New Testament about false teachers and false prophets. And one of the flaws that they have among many is that they do not learn before teaching. See, friends, there were many people that day listening to Jesus on the Sermon on the Mount. But on the front row, if you will, were Jesus' disciples. And he's giving them this warning that undiscipled disciple makers are not a good idea. It's a bad thing when someone doesn't learn before teaching. That's why he spent 3 years with them, training them. See, brothers and sisters, the Christian life is by design a life of learning and teaching, and then learning and teaching, and over and over and over it goes. We are to learn before teaching. A good Bible teacher doesn't have it all figured out. We are always to be students of the Word of God, constantly. At this very moment, I'm teaching you. But going all the way back to when God saved me at the age of 13, since then to today, there have been a ton of people who have taught me. And next Sunday morning, I'm going to sit back down and be taught by someone else. Learning and teaching, learning and teaching. This is the essence of the Christian life. And this applies to parenting too. Moms and dads in the room, if you've got children in your home, you are their primary teacher of the Christian faith. That's by design. That's you and me. And we don't have to be biblical scholars to do that. We simply have to be students of God's Word who stays one step ahead of our kids, right? Which can be a challenge. So parents, if you currently don't have a regular dedicated time of family worship in your home, boy, I would encourage you to do that. I recommend to you Donald Whitney's book on the back bottom of your sermon notes called Family Worship. That book is $6 on Amazon. Some of you are going to blow that on an appetizer at lunch today. And it's only 80 pages long. And once you read that book, moms and dads, you may, depending on the age of your kids, you may have to apologize to them. And then you'll need to repent and start a new habit in your family. That habit being family worship. I commend that to you. Because again, you're their primary teacher of the Christian faith. The Christian life is a life of learning and teaching, learning and teaching. And Jesus continues to make this point by using a funny illustration. Letter B on your outline is a funny illustration. You know, when we look at verses 41 and 42, there's a couple of words that are key here in this funny illustration, and that is a log and a speck. Let's start with a speck. A speck would have been just a tiny speck of dirt or sawdust, but a log would have actually been a wooden beam of some sort, like this, that was used in construction, okay? Would have been like a support beam, a good sized plank. And so Jesus' illustration went something like this. Okay. Do y'all know Brother Gordon out here? Do y'all know Brother Gordon? Stay right there, my brother, just stay seated. Brother Gordon, I want to tell you, all the way from up there, I see that you have a speck in your eye. And what I want to do, Brother Gordon, is I want to get that speck out. Now, please, trust me, I can see clearly to do this, okay? So you just hold still. I want you to open wide, not your mouth, your eye, open wide. There we go. I got it. You see how absurd this illustration is? You get Jesus' point? It's a funny illustration, but friends, it's also a sad illustration. Because the speck and the board represent sin. Both of them do. See, we are to help each other see the sin in each other's lives. As brothers and sisters in Christ, we are to help one another overcome and fight sin in each other's lives. But before either of us can be effective in doing that for one another, we've got to have a great awareness of our own sinfulness to be able to see the board that's sticking out of our own eye. Take a look at the second half of verse 42 and look at Jesus as he keeps on going. In this absurd illustration, he says, "You hypocrite." The word there for hypocrite is actor. You hypocrite, you actor, you pretender. First take the log out of your eye, then you will see clearly to take the speck in your brother's eye. See what he's doing there? He's clarifying the kingdom fact. Remember, a kingdom fact in each one of these three contrasts is a truth that sheds light on the difference between a real follower and one who's not. And the kingdom fact here is that a person must deal with their own sin first before helping a sibling with their sin. I'm telling you, friends, if I'm blind about my own sin in my life that is so clear to other people, it's like a board coming out of my head, and then I try to help you with your sin, I'm not going to be very humble about that. And humility is a massive requirement for us helping each other fight sin and overcome sin in our lives. It's an important point. It's also an important point for church life. This is why the Apostle Paul said in Galatians to the Galatian church, he said, if someone is caught in any wrongdoing, you who are spiritual should restore such a person with a gentle spirit. Why would we do that? Watching out for yourselves so you also won't be tempted. See, sin is a dangerous thing. And Jesus never said, don't worry about the speck in your brother's eye. He never said, that speck is none of your business. That speck is not a big deal. He never said that. Because sin is a big deal. Sin's always a big deal. We are supposed to help each other overcome and fight sin. Even when sin is small, it does a lot of damage. I mean, you know this. You ever gotten something stuck in your eye? A little speck of something and it gets stuck in there and you can feel it, but oh Lord, you cannot get it. And you try to get it out, and then it begins scratching your cornea and you can shut the world down. Because everything has to stop until you get that speck out of your eye. And then when you get it out, it's such a relief, isn't it? And you think, how can something so small cause so much pain? That's the way sin is. And again, this is our responsibility to one another's in the body of Christ. I have blind spots in my life that by definition I cannot see. And I need siblings, brothers and sisters in Christ, in this local congregation, to help me see my sin. But you got to do it gently. We got to do it humbly with each other. And I know what the pushback is from some of you. Some of you are thinking right now, well, I just won't do that. I mean, I don't have the right to call out sin in another person's life. Who am I? I'm a sinner too. Be careful. That's the world talking. You look at the second half of verse 42. That's a commandment from Jesus. First, take out the log, then take out the speck. You can go back and listen to last week's sermon from Pastor Russell about love and see this very point, because if I don't love you enough to help you overcome and fight sin, and you don't love me enough to overcome and fight sin, we're not demonstrating biblical love to each other. Remember what love is? It's that self-sacrificial commitment to another person's well-being. And that last part, another person's well-being, is about spiritual blindness as well. So that's the first contrast that Jesus gives us. Blind eyes versus seeing eyes. What's the second contrast? Look at it with me. Beautiful heart versus an evil heart. Number two on your outline is a beautiful heart versus an evil heart. See, as Jesus continues to teach here, he's still hammering the same point, that those who have been changed by the gospel of grace live differently. But this time he uses a different kind of illustration. He uses a fruitful illustration. Letter A on your outline is fruitful. A fruitful illustration. Join me in verse 43 in your Bibles. And let's look at this together. He says, a good tree doesn't produce bad fruit. On the other hand, a bad tree doesn't produce good fruit. For each tree is known by its own fruit. Now stop right there. Let's think about this for just a minute. Because our temptation as modern readers of the Bible is to think we need to sort of read between the lines to figure out what Jesus is really saying. But we don't. It's plain what he's saying. Remember, there were kids on that mountainside that day listening to the Sermon on the Mount. There were uneducated people there. There were farmers and fishermen and builders and carpenters, people that were not religious experts. And they're listening to Jesus. And he gives them a fruitful illustration that just makes sense about trees and their fruit. Keep reading in verse 44. Look at what he goes on to say. He says, figs aren't gathered from thorn bushes or grapes picked from a bramble bush. Again, it's an absurd illustration. Nobody expects a thorn bush to produce figs. You know what the final test is for any tree? You know how you can tell what kind of fruit tree you're staring at that's right in front of you? Look at the fruit. Observe the fruit. Because the fruit on the fruit tree reveals the character of the tree. And Jesus says, likewise, it is with people. See, the kingdom fact in this contrast is that a person's outward actions reveal their heart. You know this deep down. You've observed it in other people. Jesus is using this metaphor of fruit here in Luke 6, but the metaphor of fruit is used all over the New Testament. Hebrews 13 tells us that the praise that we give to God is the fruit of our lips. Romans 6 tells us that personal holiness is spiritual fruit. And of course, if you know your Bible, you know Galatians 5 is the fruit of the Spirit. And it's interesting, in John 15, Jesus tells us that He is the vine, we are the branches, and apart from Him, we can bear no what? Come on, talk to me. We can bear no what? Yeah, fruit. So it's a powerful illustration that drives to this kingdom fact that a person's outward actions reveal their heart. See, the metaphor of fruit is about God producing something in His children that is external, that is seeable or visible to other people so that they know we're connected to Him. But let's be clear on this. Christianity is not about merely external behavior modification. Because any religious person, any religious system can modify the external behavior of a person temporarily. No, friends, the heart of the gospel message is a change of heart. It's what God does in us. Read verse 45 and look at it as Jesus continues. He says, a good man produces good out of the good storeroom of his what? An evil man produces evil out of the evil storeroom, for his mouth speaks from the overflow of his what? Yeah, his heart. That last phrase there really does exemplify the kingdom fact that Jesus is describing, because what comes out of the mouth reveals the true character of a person's heart. Jesus is not speaking biologically here. He's describing the heart metaphorically as a storeroom, a place where you and I would keep our treasure. Now, we'll see more teaching on this when we get to Luke 12 in the weeks to come, where Jesus talks about the heart. But here, He's reminding those of us that know Him that salvation has come to us because a heart change took place. And with the regenerating work of the Holy Spirit, our hearts change. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture, because what happens to a new Christian is a new Christian goes from having an evil and selfish heart to then having a beautiful heart once God saves them. And that beautiful heart now has the Holy Spirit residing in it. It's now what is deposited into that storeroom. So God is now our treasure. And our appetites change, and our desires change, and our direction changes, and we begin to desire the things of God. It's a heart change, friends. God changes us from the inside out. And I know we say that a lot, but let's not forget the out part of inside out, most notably how we live. The external fruit in our lives that people can see, even down to the words that we say or type or tweet or post. Those two are to be different from the world. Because again, those who have been changed by grace live differently. So, two contrasts so far. We've had blind eyes versus seeing eyes. Here in this second contrast, we've had a beautiful heart versus an evil heart. And now what do we have? This last Number three on your outline, contrast, is security versus destruction. Security versus destruction. Now, I want to be honest with you. I wish I could quit here. And I know some of you are thinking the same thing. Yeah, me too, bud. Because this is hard. At this point in the Sermon on the Mount, the stakes seem to get higher. So it's legitimate to ask, where is Jesus going with this message? I mean, he's preaching the greatest sermon ever preached. So how's he going to land this plane? Well, he does so by asking a piercing question. I want you to look in your Bibles in verse 46 and look at this piercing question that he asks. Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do the things I say? Have you ever had a time in your life where you have asked God a why question? Where you've asked him, God, why this? Why now? Why us? You ever had a time in your life like that? Yeah, me too. But here, Jesus is asking each one of them listening to him on that mountainside, and each one of us today, a why question. And unlike earlier in verse 39, the question here is not a rhetorical question. Why? Why do you call me Lord, Lord, and don't do the things that I say? See, this question is the point of application for the Sermon on the Mount, because the word Lord here in the original language means master. Let me read it to you again. Why do you call me master, master, and don't do the things that I say? That's a piercing question, friends, don't you think? I mean, think about it this way. Apply this piercing question to a parenting scenario. When you as a parent ask one of your kids to do something and you give them a clear instruction and they say, yes, I will do that, or okay, I will do that, and then they go off and they don't do it, what does that say about your relationship with them and their view of your authority in their lives? It says that they're disregarding your authority as a parent. It was well over a week ago that I had to tell both of my boys in different situations, look, son, if you don't do what your mother says, she's going to kill you. My boys are 11 and 13. You'll understand that, some of you. And I told both of them, I said, I'm like Jesus. I'm the only thing standing between you and the wrath to come. It's frustrating when our kids don't obey us, right? Friends, this question is not a funny question. And it's not the only time that Jesus referenced this issue. Actually, in Matthew's account of the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father in heaven. Don't miss that last phrase. Jesus is making the same point here in Luke 6. He's saying, you're calling me master, but you're not doing what I say you should do. Why? And as that question just sort of hangs in the air, Jesus gives us a final illustration that's actually, letter B on your outline, a foundational illustration. A foundational illustration. And once again, just like the board in the eye and just like the fruit, Jesus isn't trying to complicate things here. He's talking about two houses. And the issue is not just the two houses, but the issues are how the houses were constructed and then the weather, right? And when you get to the begin to think about this whole contrast of security versus destruction, it sort of makes sense why Jesus would use this kind of illustration. Because no matter where you live on the planet, the unpredictable nature of the weather and house construction really do speak to the issue of security, doesn't it? I mean, here in the U.S., out west, what do they worry about? Fires and earthquakes. In the Midwest, what do they worry about? Floods and snow. In Tornado Alley, what do you think they worry about? And here in the Gulf States and along the Atlantic seaboard, what do we worry about? Come on. Yeah, 10 days, hurricane season starts. Better be ready, right? Hurricanes. Ever since Genesis chapter 3, it's been impossible to build a house that is completely protected from the weather. So Jesus gives this foundational illustration, and these houses are different. What's the difference between the two houses? Is it the way that they look on the outside? No. Probably look the same. Is it the flood that's different? No, it's the same flood. No, the difference between those two houses was how each house was constructed. Let's take them one at a time. In the case of the first house, look at verse 48. What did the man do in verse 48? He dug what? Deep. That's beautiful. He dug deep until he reached solid bedrock, and it was on that bedrock that he laid the foundation of his house. He dug deep. Now, this is a challenge for us to think about in modern times, because in ancient cultures, it was extremely hard to build a house, particularly in an area like Israel with Israel's topography. And if you were a person who built in a valley, which is what this illustration sort of insinuates, because you're by a river, then you would have to be a person who digs deep, because you'd have to go through 8 feet of clay to get to bedrock. Friends, in that time, with those tools that they had available to them, that's a lot of work to dig that much for a house. It's not easy to dig that deep. And so it is with hearing the words of Jesus and acting on them. Brothers and sisters, it's never been easy to follow Jesus. Never. It's a hard road. It's a narrow road. That's why there are few people that are on it. But in the case of the second house, the easier choice was made, wasn't it, when that house was built? Because it was just too much trouble to dig that deep. I mean, heavens, I'm not going to spend all that time and all that effort digging deep. So the house was just built on the topsoil. And again, in that part of the world in that day, you would build in the summer because the rains came in the winter. And evidently with the second house, when the man was building in the summer, he wasn't thinking about the winter rains. I got plenty of time to shore up my house before the winter rains come. And you know what? They're not going to be that bad anyway. And it's certainly not going to flood. That was the thinking. And so it is with those who hear but do not act on the words of Jesus. I'll just come and listen. I'll just listen to the words of Jesus. But I don't want to bother acting on them. It's much easier for me just to look like a follower on the outside instead of really being a follower. Friends, please don't miss this contrast. Jesus is not trying to be coy here. He's being blunt. Because the contrast between these two builders is security versus destruction, and the flood comes. The winter rains begin, and the river swells, and it overflows its banks, and it floods, and the storm, the flood that we never thought would happen, happens, doesn't it, here? But notice who's secure in the flood. The person who hears the words of Jesus and acts on them. And what happens to the person who hears but does not act on the words of Jesus? They're destroyed. He's talking about judgment here. Those who build their lives on the foundation of the gospel have absolutely nothing to fear when the flood of God's wrath comes. Absolutely nothing. Because they are secure. But on the other hand, the consequences of pretending, the consequences of hearing the words of Jesus but not acting on them, those consequences are destruction when the judgment of God comes. Remember, I said I wish I could have stopped at the end of point two. You know, the New American Standard Translation renders James 1:22 this way. It says, "Prove yourselves doers of the word and not merely hearers who delude themselves." You know, the second builder was deluded. He thought the flood wouldn't come. He thought it wasn't important to dig deep. He thought he had plenty of time. And all he needed to do was listen to the words of Jesus. He didn't need to act on them. Is that the pattern of your life? Hearing, but not acting. Why do you call him Lord and Master? See, friends, the kingdom fact down there at the bottom of your outline is that submission to Jesus is a non-negotiable for a real follower. When we follow Jesus as a citizen of his kingdom, we obey him. Not perfectly, but we do obey him. With him as our king and as our master, we do what he says. And as a result, we live differently. Why? Because we've been changed by grace. We live distinctly different from the world because we've been changed by grace. We dig deep and we pursue personal holiness. Why? Because we've been changed by grace. The grace of the King who offers us entrance into his kingdom. I beg you today, be honest with yourself. If your faith is merely lip service, your faith won't survive the flood of God's wrath when his judgment comes. Don't delude yourselves. Because you know what? There's another option. You know, in the Old Testament, there's an amazing account of one family who heard the words of the Lord and acted on them. And it was Noah and his family. And when the flood of God's judgment came, just a glimpse of the flood of God's judgment in a very, very awful display, everyone on the planet except those eight people died and were swept up in the wrath of God. But eight people survived. And they didn't survive because they were better than everybody else. They were sinners just like those that died. But they survived because they took refuge in God's provision of a rescue vehicle, the ark. And as a result, they were delivered from the wrath of God safely. Friends, do you know today, for all who turn from their sin and trust Christ, do you know who our ark is? His name is Jesus. Well, there's another option, dear friends. And today he calls us to turn from our sin, trust him by faith, and live lives that are different from the rest of the world. Let's pray together, shall we?